Gang.
Good morning. Whoa, that went low and fast. Almost disappeared.
Shocking.
I brought it back. It's all good. Good morning, Chris. How's Canada?
Good morning, Brent. Canada is lovely. Well, my part of Canada is lovely. It could be worse than other places. Who knows? It's a big place, you know. Goes from one side of the world to the other, practically.
Practically, right?
Practically. Three whole coastlines. East, west, and north.
Indeed, indeed. It's a Wednesday.
It is. Well, we're fortunate because when we do this, Wednesday always becomes happy, right?
That's right. Makes my day. Gets us over
we
a
are.
Bump.
That's right. Rolling through. Good morning to everybody in the chat. Welcome back. Welcome if it's your first time. It's lovely to see the weather reports. Jennifer's noting that it is snowy in April in Winnipeg right now. That's the whole thing. That's why I use caution when describing the weather in Canada, because there are places that will still get disappointing amounts of things. So anyway, we have a great guest with us this week. LaTarshia Wooten is joining us. LaTarshia, introduce yourself to our gang and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Awesome. Well, as Chris mentioned, my name is LaTarshia Wooten. I'm super excited to be here with you all today. A little bit of a background on me. I actually have been in the e-learning industry for a little over 4 years, but I first was introduced when I was in college. It was my minor, educational media, and so I got the opportunity to play with all the kind of cool tools. I even got introduced to 3D printing and a variety of other things. And then right after college, I kind of fell into marketing. My major was communication studies. And so I kind of was working in the marketing field for a little bit. And then I eventually moved on and became a digital marketing and learning specialist for a small company in Chesterfield or Midlothian, Virginia. And that's when I got introduced to e-learning, from learning management systems to creating e-learning to building videos to a host of a lot of things. And also got the opportunity to speak at a few conferences while working there. Mm-hmm. And now I'm a learning experience designer. So mm-hmm. I'm excited to be here.
That's very cool. Awesome. I think it's really cool that, first off, you got to do educational media in college, because there's an awful lot of us who that wasn't a thing. and then 3D printing too. That's a lot of fun. That's very cool.
Yes. I think one of the things I loved about it was the fact that where one of the internships that I worked, you could see it happening in real life. And so I got the opportunity to create like some cool things. So
nice.
I got to create like holders or like things for like phone devices, like the ways to put like your plugs and all of the different things. So it was just really cool. And I also got to help other people learn how to use it as well.
Oh, back in our day, they called it shop class. We worked with wood. and we made magazine holders.
Okay.
A corner shelf, you know. Everybody went home with a corner shelf.
No 3D printers back then.
No. Everybody's house you went to visit, they had a corner shelf, and you knew their kid had gone through high school.
Kid built it, yep. Shop class, baby. Shop class.
Oh, boy.
Yes,
nice.
Indeed.
So we're not talking corner shelves today. We are talking microlearning videos and some tips and tricks and practices to help make those better. Maybe we'll start with a little bit of how you first got into, you know, microlearning videos, you know, what you, where you started at with that.
So in my last position, as I mentioned, I was a digital marketing learning specialist. And so essentially what that was, because I work for a small accounting training firm, and we got into the point where we were starting to create these cute commercial videos, but we started to realize we were providing so much valuable information that they kind of turned into microlearning videos. And so Essentially, like, the accountant would create like the storyboard, and then they'll pass it on to the DMLS, which was us. And then we would kind of figure out how to make it fun and entertaining. And at the time, a lot of the videos we did were themed, right? So we had zombies, we've had where you had like queens and like different things, fun things. We did some based off movies. And so eventually it kind of turned into like, wait, these are providing like so much content in these short 3 to 4 minute. And so eventually we started to really try to incorporate that in what we were doing to kind of provide the learners with something, you know, that's visually appealing, that doesn't take a lot of time, and they're cute. And like, because they were themed, people were able to, I remember that video, such and such was doing such and such. And so that's kind of how we got into it and how I got really introduced to it. Of course, you hear about microlearning videos throughout time. It became like a huge thing over the last few years, if not more. People are like, I want microlearning, even if it's not just a video or just a microlearning, like a using, you know, content, like an authoring tool, you have that option as well. But videos are something that people really can spend not a lot of time on, and they can watch it wherever they are on any device. So it just became really popular. Mm-hmm. And that is how I kind of got into it more.
Yeah, it must have been. Sorry, Chris. But I was just going to mention the connection with marketing and learning, right? That's what we've had a lot of sessions with folks talking about that and making that connection. So when you were giving your intro, I just wanted to bring that all back together, mentioning that you started out on a marketing team. I'm like, oh, of course, you know, it makes perfect sense that transition. I can see where this story's going, because a lot of folks have, gotten to e-learning or learning experience design through that technical channel. Mostly educators come into our world, but yeah, then there's other marketing folks who end up creating it. And I think YouTube had a lot to do with that, right? You know, the rise of YouTube and that whole thing, and all of a sudden people trying to figure out, what's the best kind of video to put on YouTube? And everyone started seeing people do really short ones, and it's like, ooh, those are doing really well. I wonder, you know, we should make more of those. And people are learning things from those short videos. I wonder if we can co-opt it and brand it and call it something cool like microlearning.
I think you're totally right. I mean, think about it. Whenever you're trying to figure out how to do something, right, you're going to go to YouTube. Like, yeah. how to cook this, how to build this, how to do this. And YouTube is great because of the fact that they're short, right? I can spend days, or if I'm being honest with COVID, I've spent so much time on YouTube learning different things. I've been self-teaching myself how to bake. And I've been just on YouTube because they're short and they get to the point really quickly. I don't have to sit through like these hour-long videos to kind of get to the good part, like how to make buttercream.
Well, maybe that's our first tip for the day then, you know, it's like getting to the point, right? And making your videos concise and being very targeted and getting and just making it about that very focused objective. You know, traditional instructional design has learning objectives, and those can be long and dragged out and whatever. But, you know, we kind of want them, you know, everybody wants just a little bit, you know, what they feel like they need right then. So, yeah,
it's bite size.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Tracy's mentioning in the chat that she this is how she fixed her washing machine. 5-minute video saved her $500. Woo. Well, as people who work in the corporate world, I mean, that alone gives us a great use case, right? You think of providing people with information quickly, simply, easily, and therefore saving the organization money on people making mistakes or doing wrong decisions or not knowing what to do. That's kind of a use case right there. We should just clip that and put that in every microlearning business model that we need.
Was there one particular marketing video that you did that you remember having that moment where you're like, wow, this is actually educational, this is learning? Or was it just kind of the whole experience, all of them?
So to be honest, the commercials we created were to promote the course that we were trying to sell.
Okay.
And so the commercial was kind of like a teaser into what you would see, because we would take snippets from the actual training and include it in the video. And so as potential clients or learners got the opportunity to see it, they were able to kind of see, oh, that's included. Oh, we're talking about this. So in the way it, as it became, it was a commercial, but eventually we saw like, wow, we're really focusing on like these particular things in this video. And eventually it just kind of, it turned into something else. And so that is one of the things I think is so important. A lot of people have to realize marketing and learning kind of goes together, right? If you think about it, for big corporations, they have to market their training to their employees, or if they do external. And so the best way to do that might be with a micro learning or a small commercial, simply being because it provides this visual, it provides a little bit of a tease of what they're going to get with the entire training. And sometimes that can entice a learner, especially depending on how you build it, right? If you use something that is animated, that has characters, sounds, and all of these different effects, guess what? Your audience is going to be like, oh, I need this. I need this. I want to watch more. I need to see what else happens. And so I think it's just really important to kind of think about that. And like microlearning videos can definitely do that. It can, it serves so many different purposes. A, you can brand them. B, you can, they're short, they're to the point, they're bite-sized. They tend to be focused on one thing. And then also you can kind of leave them hanging at the end. I know that sounds bad and I'm the worst person, but if you put like a little bit, like you want to know more, or like cut the video off just as you get to the good part. And they're like, if you want to see the rest, you got to take the training. So I definitely think there's a lot of pros to using it. Keeping in mind that bite size type of mindset.
Now we have officially in the description for today's session, we talked about five different ways to do this. So let's maybe just jump in there. What's the first way that that comes to mind for you?
I had did a presentation at DevLearn, and so we really talked about this. And so the five that we have is, the first one is traditional animation. And so when I say that, I mean like the one, think about like explainer videos or beyond, right? Those characters that you have scenes, you have background, you have animation, you have special effects. And then the second one, while it is still animation, is whiteboard animation. And the reason why we separate it, because we distinctly decided there are two different use cases, right? With whiteboard animation, you're really focusing more on those complex technical type of topics, right? You're trying to really understand, you're trying to take away the noise, right? Because the topic that you're talking about is already a little bit overwhelming potentially for your learner. So by removing a lot of what's in the traditional and just really have a whiteboard and you use color to focus on those key concepts. And so that would be the second one. The third one is like a compilation type of video. And so we personally, for us at the time, we used that for disclosure videos where we were taking like this heavy document and we were like, people don't want to just look at a PDF, right? We need to spice it up. And so we end up taking different other types of video or media and combining it into one. And then the fourth one was PowerPoint. And the reason being was because we had to think about like, not everyone can afford to pay for these expensive softwares, these subscription, but PowerPoint gives you the capability to create microlearnings. While we personally, it's not probably one of the most popular ones we would suggest, it is doable. And you can also record yourself, you can add audio and things like that. So you still have that capability. And then the last one is just traditional style video with a camera, maybe creating your own studio, or to be honest, we live with such high technology, like your phone. Mm-hmm. Your phone could be your video. You just need a good microphone and you can really do it. So those were the five types that we kind of talked about. And they all have pros and cons, all have different use cases. So for instance, if you're trying to do a microlearning in this, mainly like HR, right? Or, and you're trying to focus on like scenarios, right? And you want to show a visual of how the learner or the employee should interact with another employee. That is a great way. You're using characters. You're able to visually show, you're able to create a background scenes to really depict what could happen in a situation. And those are like one use case, like explainer videos or scenario type videos. And then you have like traditional, right? Say you're a teacher, like my husband currently is back in college. And so his teacher sends like these small videos of her teaching, and she's on the whiteboard or she's depicting something that she's trying to show her class how to do. Those are still considered microlearning. They're not long, they're very short and to the point. And I think that those types of videos have certainly, each of these different types of methods have different use cases, and just understanding what you're looking for, what if you're a freelancer, what your client's looking for, if you're working with a corporate company, what they're looking for. So those are kind of like the five methods. But I want to stress, like, there are so many other ways. You can do screencasts, like where you're like showing your screen and you're trying to depict like how to do something, or say you're teaching someone how to use Excel, right? I've been to YouTube plenty of times trying to figure out how to add a formula to an Excel sheet. Those are microlearning videos too. So, I mean, there are so many different ways to do it. I think it just depends on what your need is, how you're trying to reach your learner, and like those different types of concepts and things.
Mm-hmm. And there's going to be a range of things too. I mean, certain types of tasks or problems that we're looking to solve, short and sweet, don't need a lot of extra added on potentially. Mm-hmm. But then you get into maybe things that we would, you know, traditionally called the soft skills or whatever, where certainly video provides a great way to provide models then, you know, like you were saying, mm-hmm. examples of behaviors, et cetera. So that leads you to, you know, potentially a different pathway where you need maybe a couple of people who are willing to be your actors, your characters, or what have you in a case. And, which is a little bit different than just doing a quick screen capture of a walkthrough of a bunch of steps in a software tool. So, yeah, we've already got some great questions in the question panel. So, let's start off with Jennifer's question. What balance would you suggest between entertainment and instruction when making short instructional videos for blended or online learning or quite formal courses?
I think it's really important to keep that in mind when you're storyboarding or writing your script, because you don't want to be distracting, right? While I am a huge advocate for adding fun elements, I think it's important that you balance it well, because you don't want to get the message that you're trying to convey. You don't want it to get lost because they're looking at, oh, that was so cool, look what they did. So I think it's important that you kind of really keep it to a good minimum of like the entertainment piece and then the instructional piece, and like weave it in. So for instance, say like the scenario example I gave, that one you could probably have like a nice, your scene itself could be built with a nice corporate office type setting, but it's maybe like not at the forefront, right? Being mindful of your colors, being mindful of all the different animation pieces, keeping that at the forefront and kind of like maybe putting like a blur on the background so that your characters are really the main focus, but you still have that graphic and visual pieces. The reason being is that sometimes, and I'm guilty of this, I get so caught up when I'm building videos where I'm like, I want the bells, I want the visuals, I want the sun like coming up, and like as it comes up, it glows. Like I'm all for that. But we also want to keep in mind, the more customized you make these microlearning videos, while they might be microlearning to your learner or who you're creating them for, they're no longer microlearning for you creating them, right? It's no longer, it's taking you a good amount of time, like it would a video that's possibly longer. So I do think it's important to keep that balance, and also just keeping in mind the type of software you're using, what are the capabilities and things like that. Because I find that a lot of times we want to like have it all pretty and all of these different things, but the learner may have just walked away. Oh, wow. Did you see that they had like an imitation of, I don't know, like Elf in the video, but they totally missed the overall concept.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, that's something that e-learning in general, we always have to kind of work that balance too. You know, sometimes not everything needs, not everything needs a scenario. Not everything needs, gamification or some of these other tools that we can, you know, bring in for, sometimes it's short and sweet, just get it done. And then even the entertainment aspect of things. I mean, entertainment doesn't, having personality, if you're a real person telling people something, and even if you're not making jokes or whatever, that's, that alone has a little bit of authenticity, sorry, that's the word I was looking for, but also a connection, right? Even if, as opposed to the formal reading by a narrator of step one, you know, so you don't have to go out and, you know, script out a huge thing, just thinking about ways that you can increase the human connection that makes something that more, you know, more liable for people to, you know, connect with the content, to stick with it and to take it away. And taking it away is the next question. This is really kind of fun. Question from Donald Clark, who promo is actually our guest next week for next week's session. Donald's joining us this week and added this question in. Research shows video suffers from transience effect. You forget a lot as you go, like a shooting star. Your memory burns up behind you. What do you do to prevent this? Video is rarely enough on its own. And that, I mean, that leads to a lot of things, yeah. extra resources. But I was thinking as we got started, and this is, I'm going to share this story here because we've dropped the time, you know, factor in that, make it short and sweet. I got a task that I have to do. I actually want to put pickups in two of my acoustic guitars. And so I did a Google for installing this particular brand of pickup. I had the basic gist, but I wanted to confirm what the experts do. And I stumbled upon the second recommendation was a video by a Canadian guitarist. I mean, I know about him. I'm a fan of his. I thought, well, let's check out what he, so it's 40 minutes, this video, which I was expecting 10 to 12 minutes, but I'm like, okay, but it's absolutely the most rambling and tangential thing. He started at his house talking in his driveway and he says, we're going to go down the road to my buddy who's a luthier. And then he literally walked down the road while his wife filmed him. And then the two guys had this chit chat. So I got all the pieces out of it that I need. And I was able to sort of make mental notes that, oh, okay, first of all, we're going to do this and then this and this and this. But I absolutely loved hanging out with these guys for 40 minutes and it was nothing but humans, you know, being human. It wasn't big story, but I still managed to leave with the things that I needed to know, as I went along, you know, quick notes, basically of the steps. So time isn't always, a negative thing, but being able to make sure that people do leave with what they need is obviously what we got to do as corporate people, as corporate training people. So, and Donald's actually added here, calls to action work well, to go and do something. Yeah. The over and over again, right? We're not just information presenters. We're trying to help people actually modify behavior or improve how they do something or, you know, carry it over. So, yeah.
And maybe, I love the call to action piece.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and maybe this is, it would be an interesting time to look at the whole instructional side of things, right? Like most people that come into, you know, from the technical side into this world of ours, at some point they're like, wow, I had no idea there was this thing called instructional design. Did you have that moment?
Oh, yes. as I have mentioned to you both, my specialty is more on the tool side, right? Like I'm all about learning about how new tools work. I love figuring out how to play with them. I'm always ready to like try a free trial to see if I want to invest in it. But there is an instructional piece to it. It is a point where you have to figure out how to lay out the content, how to best present it, and how to really connect with your target audience. In the presentation we did this past fall, we talked about when it comes to microlearning, there's like three types of phases. You have pre-production, production, and then post-production. And in that pre-production, that is when we really talk about the fact that you really need to research what you're doing. You can't, unless you're like SME, but if you're doing a random topic that you have no idea what it's about, you need to research. And then you really need to tailor that research to focusing on that one bite-sized type of learning objective, right? Because the research will help guide you as you're creating your video. And then we also talk about the importance of actually laying out what you're doing, depicting what's going to show, when, how is it going to show. And a lot of times, it's important to think about your visuals, right? And so thinking about that instructional piece, it's like, well, what video is going to help convey this message better? Which action is going to help make sure the learner walks away with, say you're doing a video, like you said, guitars, walk away with knowing this is the method they have to use. This is the moment they do it in these steps. And so I think it's really important that you focus on that instructional design piece, because honestly, if not, it's going to just mainly be a video of entertainment. And going back, it's like we as human, we will watch videos that's longer than a microlearning because we're interested in it. Yeah. I will watch a video about baking while I, if I'm not learning how to do it, if I'm just watching a cooking show on YouTube, I will sit there for the entire hour because I am invested in it. This is something I'm interested in. So those types of, it's just a balance, but I do think the instructional piece is very important because it will set you up for success later on, building that foundation, because obviously you don't want to get production and not really understand your start. For me personally, if I don't have like a tailored plan, I'm going to be talking about everything and anything in that moment. And so that's why it's important to really think about that design of it and the layout and the words, because the words need to be intentional, right? You have a short span of time. You don't have an hour for a micro learning video. So you really need to be intentional in what you're saying and what you're teaching. I really think that's really cool. And I just see someone posted TikTok has changed the game. We were talking about YouTube, but TikTok is a whole different thing. And like, I actually personally don't have TikTok, but my friends always send them to me. And I'm amazed that in 1 minute, I've learned how to do something. Yeah. Like, look, they're showing this new thing, or they're showing this new dance, or they're showing how to do this. And it's crazy. Like, it is so short, but people are really liking it because of the fact that the fact is people, time is just something that people don't feel like they have unless it's something they want to do. And so TikTok is definitely, they chased the game.
They did. And it's like Instagram and other ones when they first came out, right? They limited you. You had, what was it? It was 15 seconds. And then there was another tool at the time that I don't think exists anymore, or got bought out and changed into something else. And you had 6 seconds. So you could put a video up, but you only had 6 seconds. And then Instagram topped them and said, oh, we'll give people 15 seconds, right? But some of the most creative educational stuff that I saw done in 6 seconds, it made me just go, oh my gosh, this is awesome. And I remember writing blog posts about it at the time saying, hey, how, you know, is this nano learning? If we've got micro learning,
yes.
Like, is 6 seconds considered like super micro? Or, I mean, how do we deal with this? And the one that I always go back to, the very first one that I saw was how to make a Oreo produced it. And it was how to make a frozen Oreo dessert treat. And they literally showed you how to do it in 6 seconds. And it was just shot in the steps in the process. And you could watch it 2 or 3 or 4 times and be like, got it, you know? And I was like, wow, we need to get here. Like, this is kind of the point we need to get to, right? Maybe not to that extreme, but, you know, close.
Yeah. Kim's asking probably the universal question in the chat or in the question panel. What size is bite-sized? Is there a recommended length? And then also up in the chat, ML has suggested or offered us this infamous quote. I would make this shorter if I had the time, from Samuel Clemens, also known as Mark Twain. But the ability to take all that those steps, Brent, and put that into 6 seconds, that was all prep work. You know, they had to plan it in order to get it that small, right?
Yeah.
And they had to know what they were doing.
Right. And like, what are the most important parts of this process, and how can we visually show that particular step with each frame going by so quickly? Yeah, for sure. I mean, like you were mentioning, LaTarshia, it's all in that planning, that step one, that pre-production phase is where all the instructional design happens too, and all the thinking through of how, what is going to be the best way to get to all of these different points. Yeah, it's all coming together.
I think it's just a lot to consider.
Yeah. And Brent, you're being called out in the chat there that you didn't actually then turn around and use the knowledge. You didn't apply it. You didn't transfer it.
There was no call to action.
That's right. Well, but you know, you actually resisted the urge to go and make it, right? So, you know,
I think that was it. As much as I am an Oreo fan, I try not to eat them. I just think they do a fantastic job with their marketing. And if one happens to be laying around or at a party, I will absolutely, you know, enjoy one, but I don't make a habit of it. Yes, Jennifer, you are correct. Frozen treats are their own call to action. This is true. And, you know, I should indulge more. But if I made every single treat that I saw online, I think my...
Yeah, we'd all...
That'd be trouble.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a wonder that so many of us after a year of this pandemic haven't ended up suffering the consequences of having made every recipe that we saw online. So,
I don't know. Maybe I might be a little guilty of that one. I have been baking and eating tons of ice cream like crazy.
Ooh, that ice cream is my, that's my guilty pleasure at night. Yeah.
Yeah. Thinking about the range, I guess, of the ways that we could approach this. I mean, we've talked a little bit about, you know, prep work. You know, people have cameras on their computers. I'm using the one sitting right there right now, for example. So, and cell phones and smartphones in our pockets, all the way through to being, you know, using a DSLR if you need to do, you know, wanted to go with something a little more robust, through to, you know, dedicated video cameras. The marketing type videos that your group was making where you first started down this pathway, what kind of equipment was being used for that?
So it depends on which type of video we were doing. The style of the video really kind of goes with the content. So you need to figure out what kind of content, like the appropriate style. Mm-hmm. So for instance, a lot of those commercials we use Beyond or VideoScribe and that's like a software, but there are plenty of others. Beyond is probably like one of the more expensive ones, if I'm being honest, but they do offer they have assets, special effects, audio, they have background music. I mean, it's a really good tool and it's fairly, in my opinion, easy to use. And you can also import graphics there as well. However, if we were doing like a traditional video with a camera, we use a DSLR. At the time we created a video studio where we had the lights, the backdrop, and we, and while that is something that we were able to do, I do think it's something to consider if video is something you're going to do very frequently. But the first, one of the things we talked about in our presentation, the cost of that is very expensive, especially the first time around. But what I like to say is once you make that initial investment, you're good to go. You are, you've got your camera, you have your lights, you have your microphones. Professional microphones is the one thing I will suggest across all boards. Regardless of which style you're using, your audio has to really be crisp because you don't want to be distracting to the learner if your audio is poor. So that's kind of like the tools we use. Mainly, like I said, we would use Beyond or VideoScribe. VideoScribe is a whiteboard animation tool. And that one's really cool because you can do like SVG files and upload them and it would animate. Unlike with Beyond, the animation isn't as smooth as I can say. Like it would like slide in, you can wipe it in. But with VideoScribe, if you was to upload it, you can like see it drawing out like it would be with all the other native assets to that software.
Yeah. And how are people accessing this content?
Do you mean like the commercials and things that was created?
Yeah. I mean, one of the things with microlearning is that we typically, if we're looking to solve a problem, we don't really, in a hurry, we're not looking to lock it up in an LMS. So were you guys running these, you know, on a website or
on YouTube? Yes. Okay. So there's some on the website and they're also on YouTube. So at the company at the time, we just posted them up. So anytime we'll be ready to release a new course that pertains to that particular topic, we'll just put it on YouTube so that the people can access it. And then we'll also post it other places. And also it was on the website where we would post the actual content. So I don't necessarily think you should gate unless it, like the beauty part about microlearning is that you can use them in a variety of different ways. The way we were using was to kind of bring people in, entice them to take the whole training. But it could be used differently. Like say you're creating a series of different microlearnings, you could pack them up into like a path, a learning path. You could take pieces out, say, oh, this one fits better here, this one fits better over here, or use them in multiple ways. Like that's the beauty of a microlearning. It can fit in so many different pockets. Like don't feel like if you create something, think about reuse, right? When you're creating a microlearning, think about how you can reuse it in different situations and things. So, but that's like how we would typically use it. But I really think like when you're thinking about microlearning in general, like think about reuse, think about the type of content that you're trying to show to kind of help you choose your style. I really think those are important things to kind of think about in that pre-production phase.
Yeah, for sure. Kim's pointing out that her organization started storing videos on Microsoft Stream, which is part of the Office 365 package. So if your organization is an Office 365 based organization, there is a streaming video service there, which hopefully helps solve the problem for a lot of organizations that don't want to put content up in YouTube, for instance, because it is, you know, internal proprietary. That kind of an approach. And we got a couple of really neat questions too. Paul's asking in the chat about, it tracking in any way, potentially using say XAPI. And there's also then some questions in the chat too about ROI and measuring things that the effects that the content has. If something's in an LMS, of course, we know completions and we know that people took the test and they got the passing score or something like that. But when we start going outside of the fences of an LMS, we start having to, you know, figure out different ways to even know what's going on, how many people watched videos and that sort of thing. What kind of things did you guys have in place for that?
We, at the time, when I was there, we didn't use XAPI, but because the videos were on YouTube, we were able to see views.
Exactly. Yep.
We were able to get that analytics about like how many times people watched it, how long people were there. So we were able to get that information. And so I think that is really important when you're thinking about posting, especially if it's like something for internal use, like do the software you use to host your videos give you that kind of data? Because I think that's really valuable. And I think what we found is that the videos that had the most views were the videos that was most purchased. And so I think that kind of can help you with the ROI and return of investment, right? And also you want to think about... when you're thinking about return on investment, you kind of want to think about also if you're showing a microlearning and then you then later test it, if someone does well, then obviously you're getting the outcome that you want, right? Because if they're doing well on these assessments and they're out being able to perform their jobs correctly or able to execute what they learn, then I feel like you're getting, I mean, it may not be financial return on investment, but you're getting the outcome that you're looking for.
Yeah, I mean, you have to move beyond just the video itself. I guess that goes back to Donald's earlier point, too, about moving beyond simply just the presentation of information. What are we doing to follow up on this content? Or what are we providing so that people can take it away and still, you know, retain it and apply it, et cetera? Which is always this is kind of the challenge really of all ROI, you know, things is figuring out and actually doing the work, let's just put it that way, of actually going out to the past the training smile sheets or the pass scores, et cetera, and then actually determining is this actually having an effect, which is always such a big challenge in so many organizations. Just the amount of work that can often involve, for instance, is often considered a barrier to doing that.
Yeah, and I think it's sometimes kind of hard when you're like looking at like a mic, say you have the microlearning view, that's where you're like pre-production, like getting all that information and like balancing the entertaining with the instructional design piece is really important. Because at the end of the day, while microlearnings are fun to create and they're quick and they're easy, and people have shown that people who watch them, they retain the information a little bit easier, because sometimes when you watch an hour long video, it's kind of hard to be like, wait, what did I learn like 30 minutes ago or even 20 minutes ago? Like, it's kind of hard to pick out what are the key things to walk away with. Unlike with a microlearning video, you're going to know right away because they keep talking about that one thing. They keep going back to that one bite-sized learning objective. And I think that is where that balance comes in when you're thinking about, okay, so they watched it. How do I know that they're applying it? Well, if you're doing something, say for sales, right? And they're, how are your sales reps doing like this particular thing you taught them? Say you're teaching them how to create something or create this or create an account or whatever the case may be. If you're getting feedback from their higher ups, oh my gosh, like things are formatted correctly. They're doing things in a proper order. That's also a way to show that training's working. Mm-hmm. You can also do a self-assessment so they can test themselves. Like, oh my gosh, I took this training and now look, I feel better prepared. Everything's organized. I'm able to engage with my clients better. I'm making more money because I'm doing things correctly. So I think those are just really important things to kind of think about. I mean, balance with microlearnings are, I'm not saying that they're the end be all, like everything should be microlearning. That's not the case, because that's not everything has that type of use case. But I'm saying when you do them, it's just figuring out that balance, figuring out the style, understanding what exactly you're trying to say, I think will just all play a part.
For sure. And obviously, you know, people need a lot of training before they can do a job. Microlearning isn't the suitable approach for that. You need a you know, formal learning with a scaffolding structure to move people through and build skills, et cetera, you know, before you put them into a place where they actually can begin to do that job. But along the way, you might have created a lot of little bits of content that could be used as microlearning afterwards for refreshers or quick checks, you know, reinforcements and reminders. So
yeah, would you recommend for folks that that they should learn a little bit more about video production and what makes like a good shot and proper lighting, all that kind of stuff? Is that something you'd recommend for a lot of instructional designers? Because I get questions all the time, like, I want to upskill. Or I'm new. You know, what should I learn, Brent? You know, where should I start? All that kind of stuff. And a lot of times I kind of scratch my head and I'm thinking, well, do you know how to make video? Yeah. That might be a good place to start.
I think that is extremely viable, because like, even if you're not creating like a microlearning, you just want to create video being added to courses is really viable, because it can kind of help people see what you're trying to tell them. Sometimes words just isn't enough. And so I would highly recommend it. Like, I don't think you necessarily need to go out and spend a lot of money on a DSLR camera. Like, we have phones now that are very powerful. I think it's important to understand like design in general, like how to really set up your screen, how to lay out different graphics, how to not overcrowd or overwhelm your learner at different times. I think that's really important as well. I think it's also important to think about lighting and microphones and really doing quality audio, and also keeping in mind background music can be distracting. I think there's so much that goes into video that a lot of people think, oh, I can just do this. But while quality is not necessarily like, obviously you want them to get the content, that's the most important piece. But if the quality of the video is bad, or the production or the editing part isn't good, it's distracting, and the learner or your client or your employee isn't going to really walk away, because they're going to be so distracted by the static in the audio. They're going to be distracted by weird, you know, things happening on the screen that shouldn't be happening. So I think it's just really important to really focus on, you know, going through the foundations of learning how to do video, how to use the equipment and the software that you're using. But I think it's also important to just really understand design, because video at the end of the day, it is a good amount of it is design and production and post-production with editing and things like that.
Yeah, for sure. I've thrown a couple of our own dominKnow resources into the chat as we've gone along. Brent's got a really nice blog post about just the idea of framing in your video-based e-learning that I threw a link in there too, in one of our blog posts. So a couple of things that people might want to follow up on and learn more. It's a vast sphere of things to learn when it comes to video. I mean, people do whole university degrees in you know, film, et cetera, to understand how to communicate in this medium. And then they continue learning for the entire rest of their lives. And of course, our consumption of video throughout our lives, videos, TV shows, movies, et cetera, has we all know what good is, even if we don't have the words to express it. And when something isn't good, our brain says, whoa, that isn't good, you know, which can interfere with even the small things like quality of sound.
Product is the hard part. We see it, we know what we like, but then to make what we want look like that, that's always the hard part, right? And that's where the learning comes in, and just doing it over and over again. I can't emphasize enough in this conversation with folks that getting out there and watching the YouTube video is great, but if you really want to get good at this stuff, you have to make stuff. Just keep making over and over again. The first one you're going to make is going to be bad. So just accept it and just make a bad one. Like, I always tell people, do your best when you're first learning something to make it as bad as you possibly can. Right. So, because if that's your goal, now you're not going to feel so bad about it. You know? So just pretend that you just know it's going to be bad and you're trying to make it bad. Right. So make a bad one. and then make it better, and then keep working on it and make it better. Help people figure, help people feel better about going through that learning process, because that fear holds people up, I think. And so anything we can do to help people just start doing it, right? And start making the videos.
Practice makes perfect.
Yeah, yep. Right on.
But you can't practice without doing. So, like Brent, never practicing that frozen treat recipe.
Brent, I was just so enamored that I could figure it out in 6 seconds. I was like, oh, wow, that was all I was interested in. Yeah. I was like, dang it, how the heck did they do that?
Well, as Paul is suggesting in the chat, there are no bad cookies.
Yeah, this is true.
Very true. There's the music. LaTarshia, thanks so much for joining us. This has been an awesome conversation. Take a minute and throw your contact info, where people can connect
sure.
with you. If you've got that handy, if people want to connect with you after today's session, throw that into the chat.
And all the other cool things. This has been a great conversation. And PowerPoint, QuickTime, all those fantastic tools that are out there to do this kind of stuff, that are either free or cost too much,
We can continue this conversation as well in the official LinkedIn group for IDIODC, which Brent's just tossed that link into the chat. Join us there. Keep in touch with us there. We have Donald Clark, as we've mentioned already, joining us for next week's session, and we're looking forward to that conversation. Let's dance on out of here, guys. Happy Wednesday. Enjoy the rest of the week, and we'll see you guys next week.
Enjoy the weather. Enjoy the week. Enjoy the weekend.
Thanks so much, LaTarshia.
Yes, thank you for having me.
Talk to everybody next week.
Indeed.